I'd like to welcome you all to today's grand opening of our new facilities, including the operating theater suite, the medical surgical ward, and the imaging facilities. I just wanted to again say thank you so much for all of your individual support in this process. We know it's been a long process for both the Tattersalls prior to the purchase of the facility by the Vanderpools in 2010. And we're going to go through some of this history and explain what it has taken to get to this point. Well, the welcome's been completed. So now we're going to move on to the history, which is going to be given by Dr. Vanderpool. But prior to that, I'd definitely like to welcome some of our distinguished guests and thank them for attending today's event. First, I'd like to welcome and recognize the Premier, Dr. The Honorable D. Orlando Smith, our First Lady, Mrs. Lorna Smith, and then our Minister of Health, Ronnie Skelton, and then the Deputy Director of the Social Security Board and the Director of the National Health Insurance, Mr. Barry. Thank you guys for all being present, and of course, all of our friends and family who are here today. And of course, Bishop Klein, who has been very instrumental throughout this entire process in providing both guidance and support for our family. Now, we'll proceed with a brief history of the Bougainville Clinic project. Thank you.
I thank you all very much for making the effort to come out on this Saturday morning when, of course, there are many other things that you could have been doing. As you know, this hillside is called Russell Hill. The back road behind here is, so the road going up is Russell Hill Road, and the road at the back of this building is called the Abbott Road. In the 16th century, there was a Dutch fort on the other side that defended the road harbor. And subsequently, when the English buccaneers beat out the Dutch buccaneers, it became the Virgin Islands changed hands to become British. And from there on, there was an English fort built on the same site. In the Rotong area, the forts were very important for the defense of the harbor. So there are four forts defending Road Harbor, of which this Fort Rotong was a fairly central and strategic one. There is Fort Burt on the west, Fort George on the Fort Hill on the east, Fort Charlotte in the mountain just at the top, a very good vantage point, but I don't think they could have gotten a cannon from up there over, but it was more for visualization. And Fort Rotong was right here. The sea was actually coming in no more than about 30 feet away from this, well, probably 50 feet away from the building, this building at that time. So it was very well strategically located. The site was purchased from the local owners, a New York couple called Harvey Smith and Ben Piazza, in about 1953. And they proceeded to build what would have been the first hotel. I mean, there were guest houses in town, but this would have been the first kind of formal hotel with a swimming pool in the British Virgin Islands back in 1953-54. In those days, there were no heavy construction equipment, and all excavation, mixing of concrete, lifting of heavy material had to be done by hand. Building proceeded very slowly, and the local people actually called this building, which wasn't the Purple Palace, then they called it the Judgment Day Hotel because they felt that Judgment Day will come before the hotel was finished. So it was called the Judgment Day Hotel, according to Miss Carmelita O'Neill. She told me, that's what she told me. I'm sticking to that. Okay, that was what it was called. The original owners were art collectors, and as such, you can find some authentic artifacts in this building. As a matter of fact, we have two important artifacts from Mark Twain's house. You know Mark Twain, the famous writer from about 200 years ago? We actually have authentic artifacts that are registered, according to Dr. Tattersall, with the Mark Twain Historical Society, and they have been here at least once to check them to make sure they really exist and have them documented somewhere. There were also some Chinese artwork that came from the Chinese dynasty period about 300 or 400 years ago, and that artwork is what forms the reception area over on the outpatient side of the clinic. Construction of the Purple Palace Hotel lasted from 1954 to 1959, and in preparation for commissioning of the opening of the hotel, by now referred to as the Purple Palace Hotel, the general manager who came in from New York employed only one local housekeeper. And guess who that housekeeper was? A lady called Geneva Vanderpool Nee Harrigan, who had recently arrived from Anguilla via St. John's. And that lady happened to be my mother. So it's an interesting circuitous route of coming back to her. Unfortunately, the period of work lasted only 6 months, and my mother lost her job because the hotel closed down when the gay couple got into a gay quarrel. And I'm told that the younger of the gay couple ran off with the gay architect and left the Mr. Harvey Smith, who then finally decided, I'm closing it down, and he went back to New York. The Purple Palace Hotel remained boarded up, and I'm told that the youngsters in Rotong played coop and other games up here, and we have some of those youngsters sitting in front of me today, like Dr. Smith, who is now the premier. Imagine playing coop through the alleys of Purple Palace, and Ronnie Skelton, I was told that he too played coop up here. You all know the game coop? And anything else, okay. Okay, so the Purple Palace was abandoned for about 14 years until 1973, when it was bought by Dr. Robin Tattersall for the grand sum of $120,000. Could be $120,000 at that time. It was a large sum of money. I had never seen such a big purchase before. The Purple Palace was thus reborn as the Bougainvillea Clinic to become internationally famous as a plastic surgery center. Okay, so the clinic occupied this eastern part of the building, and the western part of the building was variously used for Dr. Tattersall's family home. It was also an art gallery, and it was also at one point a restaurant called the Veranda Restaurant in the last few years, just before it was sold to the Vanderpools. On January 10, 2010, that marked the end of a somewhat lengthy and convoluted period of negotiation with the Tattersalls for the purchase of the property and business at a cost of $3 million. Okay, so we jumped from $120,000 to $3 million. Times have changed. The value of money had not been so good. There was also a lengthy and convoluted process to get government to transfer the hospital license from Dr. Tattersall to me, Dr. Vanderpool, to operate the hospital at the same site. The effort to transform the Bougainvillea Clinic from what it was to what it is today, while maintaining the historically significant features and artifacts, has been a long and arduous process. It's taken 7 years to come to this point, and I would like, because it's such a long process, if you have been keeping track, you will notice that we have celebrated one milestone after another. The first milestone was the opening of the outpatient department when my dear mother, Geneva, cut the ribbon back in January 2011. Unfortunately, she's not here to cut the ribbon today, but she certainly would have liked to be here because she constantly gave me the encouragement when I felt like giving up and feeling that it was too long and arduous a process. I think the neighbors in the vicinity deserve my humblest apologies for the great inconvenience this transformation has caused them in terms of noise, vibration, dust, and changing in the environment. I would particularly like to mention the Abbott Smith family, who had to tolerate the most inconvenience. I'd like to extend my apologies to the Massac family, who have also been inconvenienced on many occasions, and to the O'Neills. I see Mr. Reggie Penn in the back, and his his family and their properties have also suffered some inconveniences, as well as to the Penns, the Penn family, the Penns and the O'Neills, yes. So I hereby, as I'm just reading what I had written, I hereby humbly ask your continued tolerance as we continue with subsequent phases of the development. But the inconvenience was not caused only by the Bougainvillea Clinic project. The traffic pattern on Russell Hill Road and Abbott Road has seen a major change in the last several years because of the opening up of the Paul Whatley Road over the hill from Lower Joe's Hill, and also the road from Seacoast Bay across up to Fort Charlotte and down. And that has thrown a tremendous amount of traffic into this small congested road, which was not intended to bear that kind. So I'm looking to the government, who are in control of the roads and the traffic, to do what they can to help us neighbors up here on Russell Hill to improve things. Right. Now, I want to mention something that was very important, because prior to those roads opening up, this road was a quiet private driveway. As a matter of fact, Dr. Tattersall was so proud of his private driveway that he called it the external ramp. You see, the building was on three different levels. There was no elevator. So how do you get a patient from the operating table on the upper floor to the lower levels? You basically went outside to our private external ramp with three or four people holding the stretcher, trying to prevent it from ending up down in the Abbott Smith's yard. And that I had occasion to envision my patient possibly ending up down in the bakery, Rotom Bakery, with a big loaf of bread in the mouth just after waking up. But that never happened, thankfully. So that continued for about 3 years after we purchased the clinic, until the elevator was installed. That elevator is of central importance to all the other activity that you have seen here. Okay. Our next major challenges will be to create adequate parking and to improve the traffic flow in the area. My first challenge, if the Dr. Smith gives me permission, is to erect a multi-story car park on the piece of land at the back of this property and have a connecting bridge across to the upper level. So we are hoping that will come to fruition once the plans are submitted for that. I want to thank you all. She said a brief history, right? So let me get on. Thank you.
Over this last 7 years, we've been able to expand the services available at the Bougainvillea Clinic to offer multi-specialty medical and surgical services right here on the island. We'll start off with the orthopedic surgery, which is staffed by Dr. Christoph Ahrens, including total knee replacement and total hip replacement, repair of major and minor fractures, and also using state-of-the-art repair techniques. We also offer ear, nose, and throat surgery by Dr. Davis, tonsillectomy with and without adenoidectomy, operations of the ear and ear drum, operations of the neck, the voice box or the larynx, and the trachea or the windpipe, thyroid surgeries, and thyroid biopsies. All of these would not be possible without anesthesiology services, which are provided by Dr. Craig Stout. These include both regional and general anesthesia for adults and children. And then, of course, our general medical facilities and services, which are available right here in the Bougainvillea Clinic, staffed by Dr. Bowen. Also, dermatology, which we're very proud to have staffed by one of our very own, Dr. Shakima Stout. Including excision of lesions, surgical procedures and minimally invasive treatments, and also skin biopsies and cryotherapy. We also offer aesthetic services provided by Florenda Ruffel-Smith, who's our licensed aesthetician. These include laser skin procedures, hair removal, acne treatment, and cosmetic procedures on all skin types. Also microdermabrasion and chemical peels for all that sun damage we have here in the Virgin Islands. Spinal and neurological surgery performed by Dr. Jeffrey Liebert, including both cervical, which is your neck disc arthroplasty, drainage of epidural fluid collections, cervical and lumbar discectomies, and fusions, along with facet joint injections and shunt placements. Urologic surgery is also very important here locally, including vasectomy, circumcision, surgery for the kidneys, bladder, and prostate, and related organs, and also other urologic operations and procedures. Our urologist is Dr. Thwaites. In terms of our general and gastroenterology offerings, those are performed by Dr. Goldsmith Alaya, including general surgery, both laparoscopic and open, laparoscopic being using a keyhole incision to address internal organs, major abdominal surgery, colon cancer surgery, and hemorrhoid surgeries. Gynecologic surgeries performed by Dr. Ramatar, including hysterectomy and myomectomy, laparoscopic tubal ligation and reconstruction, operations on the external female organs, ovarian operations, and cervical operations. Dr. Frett, another one of our very own, provides our pediatric services here at the clinic, including comprehensive healthcare services from infants to adolescents. And then, of course, our very own Dr. Vanderpool, Hesketh Vanderpool, provides our cardiology services, including cardiac resynchronization and defibrillator therapy for hearts that are out of rhythm, implantable cardiac monitoring devices, and implantable MRI-compatible defibrillators and pacemakers. In addition to these services that are offered, we also offer state-of-the-art imaging facilities, which include ultrasound, digital x-rays, CT scan, and MRI scanning, along with physiotherapy, which treats a wide assortment of different pain complaints, skeletal, joint, and neck pain. We also are able to help patients rehabilitate and regain limbs, use of limbs. And finally, the urgent care and walk-in services, which was officially opened just last month, which involves management of routine and urgent health care needs and access to general and specialist doctors 7 days a week, which is also very useful for our community and for our patients who need them. And with that, we are going to move on to the next section of the program, which is going to be our first entertainment special presentation by Mr. Stephen Vanderpool.
Hello, everyone. How are you? Thank you for coming out and supporting, you know, our family as we as we officially open this building. Very proud of my dad and everything he's done here. You know, he's been, you know, I've been teasing him about it for a long time, but you know, he's made it. And for that occasion, I decided to bring this saxophone out of retirement. It's been a while, so, you know, bear with me. Thank you.
So now it is time to present our new facilities. These have been, as I mentioned, a labor of love for the staff, and many hands have had a part in allowing us to get to this point. We're going to start with the operating theater suites. These are now going to be named the Dr. Robin Tattersall Operating Theater Suites. I'm going to give you a brief history on the impetus behind and the person behind the name of this operating theater. So Dr. Robin Tattersall, born in Manchester, England. Robin Tattersall sailed to the British Virgin Islands in 1965 with his young family to take up the post of government surgeon. Whilst qualifying, a brief but spectacular career as a top male model on the front pages of Vogue and Harper's and Queen made him a household face in the mid-1950s. In 1973, he founded the Bougainvillea Clinic, unique throughout the Caribbean. With a Bachelor of Medicine and a Bachelor of Surgery at Cambridge University, Cambridge and St. George's Hospital Medical School in London, 1957-65, he completed his postgraduate surgical training in general plastic surgery at St. George's Hospital in London and Westminster Hospital and associated hospitals within London. He's an accomplished sailor and sportsman and has represented the BVI in two Olympic Games and was an international judge for the International Yacht Racing Union. Robin Tattersall managed to fit a variety of interests and memberships into his busy surgical schedule, including the NYYC and the RTYC, the Pan American Yachting Organization, and Rotary. Dr. Tattersall officially retired from his active plastic surgery schedule in 2014 and now pursues a number of personal interests with his wife, Martha, things that he had long wished to do but until now had no time to pursue. And a little bit of history that is not very well known is that when my dad was about 15 years old, he spent about 3 days in the operating theater with Dr. Tattersall when he was thinking about becoming a physician. And that was part of what prompted him to move forward with his desire to go into medicine. So Dr. Tattersall, we salute you. And we're honored to name these operating theaters after you.
Good morning, everybody. This was quite a surprise to me about this naming of this the operating theater. I didn't know about that until just now. So I'm very honored that this has happened. I think it's quite amazing to think that this is all developed from what we had all those years ago. Hesketh did a pretty good history of the place. I don't think he got much wrong at all. It's pretty good. And but I just should add, he was talking about our ramp down the road, taking our patients down. What he didn't tell you, I didn't mention, was that on the other side of the road, there was the old St. George's School, the first school they had, which was in the old Anglican manse. And as we would roll our patients down the road, the little children would, if they were out on their break, they'd all have their faces at the fence to see what the mad doctor was doing next. And strangely enough, only last week, a man, Toto, and I've forgotten who it was, who was at school at that time, his strongest memory was of these people being wheeled down, but they were all bandaged up and their faces were all covered up, and he thought they were all dead, so he thought that actually this was sort of like a mortuary. So that was great, I must say. I just one little bit of history that Pascal didn't say is that none of this would be happening except for a couple of events, and I think we've all got moments in our life which change the course of everything. And in this case, it changed mine and ultimately Hesketh's. And that was back when it was just at the time we knew that Dr. Smith was coming back and there was not going to be room for two surgeons at that time at Peebles. And so I was actually in discussion with Orlando's uncle, Leo Smith, who had been the contractor with Harvey Smith. In the building of all this, And he said, "What you need? Well, you need your own hospital." I said, "Well, that was silly. How can I have a hospital?" He said, "Well, I know that the Bougainvillea Clinic is going to come back on the market. It had not been for sale at all." And I said, "Well, I don't have any money." And he said, "Well, I'll tell you what. I'll just bring the owner when he comes. He's coming next week, and I'll bring him to you, and you'll get to see him first." Well, I saw him, and he said, "Look, I'd like you to have it, but I'm going to leave in a week, and I have to have the money all signed, sealed, the whole thing." So I went to the bank and said, "Can you give me a mortgage?" And they said, "Well, yes, 2/3. And they wouldn't lend me any more. And on the last day, of the sixth day, I heard that Percy Chubb, who was a great benefactor of our islands in those days, who had built his place on the old plantation at the little harbour in Peter Island. And I went over in a little tiny dinghy one night, with no telephones, and went to him and I told him the story. And he, after a few moments, he came out with his checkbook and he said, "How much money do you need? This is totally unsecured, interest-free loan. Pay me back when you can." And I went back and bought the building. And the only condition of this was that I continued to stay here and serve the people of the BVI. And so if that hadn't happened, I would not have been able to buy that building. Somebody else would have had it. I would have never developed it, and Dr. Vanderpool would never. So that's a little interesting twist. Thank you. Anyway, just one thing more. I'm amazingly proud of what Hesketh's done here. I mean, I could never have believed, and I thought actually he was quite mad to have bought it from me, quite frankly. I don't know how he could possibly have made the sort of facility that he has on this particular site, and I'm amazed. And he's a real pioneer and has brought so many new things to this country, which we've already related to. Thank you, Hesketh, and thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Dr. Tattersall. Our next new facility that we're going to be dedicating and naming today is in honor of my late grandmother, Miss Geneva Harrigan, and I'm going to give you a bit of her bio also. Geneva Harrigan, married Vanderpool, the mother of Dr. Hesketh Vanderpool, was born in Anguilla on October 26, 1927. She moved to Tortola via St. John USBI in the late 1950s to seek a better life for her family. In 1959, she was employed at the Purple Palace Hotel, a housekeeper, but unfortunately, after 6 months of employment, the hotel closed without seeing its first guest. She raised 9 children of her own, 8 born to her and 1 adopted, and many others from Anguilla, the BVI, and the wider Caribbean. A very loving and giving woman, she was dedicated and a born-again Christian who raised her children in strict discipline, all of whom have become successful in their own right. Mama, as she's called by her children, strongly supported each of her children in their life's pursuits and was one of the strong cheerleaders for Dr. Vanderpool as he developed the Bougainvillea Clinic into a multi-specialty hospital. She performed the ribbon cutting for the opening of the renovated outpatient department in 2011, and it is believed that she would have enjoyed participating in this grand opening ceremony today, and we know that she's here with us in spirit. So the patient rooms, which are to your right, have been developed with state-of-the-art facilities, and they are dedicated in the name of Miss Geneva Harrigan. And to respond on her behalf is her first daughter, Miss Lorna Smith.
Thank you, Dr. Stephanie. Good morning, everybody. Can you imagine I'm speaking before the premier so I could say everything that he was going to say? But I won't. I will simply respond to this honor on behalf of Mama, and as all of us who knew her would say, she would start out by saying, "Even to this is a pleasure." It's an Anguilla phrase. I don't know whether it came from Dummy Fetty or who, but it's her way of responding to honors. And as Dr. Stephanie said, she is here in spirit with us, and I know that she is truly, truly honored that my brother Hesketh has accorded her this honor. Mama chose to, her last wish was for her body to be buried in Anguilla, the land of her birth. Certainly, Hesketh, naming this facility or this ward after Mama is very excellent. It's an excellent symbol of her legacy that is left here in the British Virgin Islands. So I think we should all say thank you for that extremely, extremely thoughtful gesture. I know that as a very spiritual and praying woman, she would say, and her hope would be that all who go into the wards that are named after her would be, that God would inspire the doctors to treat them to the extent that they would leave healthy again. And her hope would be that they would get the kind of attention that she received in her last days here and that all of us saw. And finally, I recall the day that she did the ribbon cutting for in 2011 for the extension of this facility. And at the time, I remember Dr. Tattersall that she specifically mentioned you as a person that she greatly admired and who looked after her, and I believe was the doctor who looked after her when she had her last daughter, Debbie. So she certainly would want me to say how pleased she is that the other ward is named in your honor. And again, thank you very much for according our mother that wonderful honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Auntie Lorna. And the third new facility that we are going to be opening and naming today is named is the imaging facility, which is going to be named in honor of Mr. Rodney Ellis. He is a PhD scientist who was born in the UK when his wife migrated to Toronto, Canada in 1968. He served as one of the directors of a large modern medical laboratory and was also the managing director of a medical ultrasound business in Toronto. He visited the BVI with his wife on several occasions, and during one of those trips, he had a conversation with Dr. Vanderpool, which led to his interest in ultrasonography. Within weeks, Dr. Vanderpool had a small scholarship to do a preceptorship in ultrasound at the Health Sciences Institute in Winnipeg, Manitoba. And upon his return, Dr. Ellis also provided the use of an ultrasound machine, which was the first ultrasound machine used here in the British Virgin Islands, in 1987. Thus, Dr. Vanderpool started the first medical ultrasound service in the BVI. Even though his contact has been lost with him, we are ever grateful to Dr. Ellis for his generosity, which was a seed in the imaging department of Eureka Medical Clinic and Bougainville Clinic. We now name the imaging department of Bougainville Clinic in honor of Dr. Rodney Ellis. So now, in honor of or in recognition of some of our very dignified guests that are here today, I would like to ask first the Premier, Dr. the Honorable D. Orlando Smith, to give some of his remarks. Thank you.
I'd like to say a pleasant good morning to all those who are here with us to the opening of this facility, this part of the facility this morning. Of course, I want to specially recognize when I speak it, Dr. Hesketh A. Vanderpool, I wonder what it is, and Mrs. Jean Vanderpool and her children, okay. And also, of course, my wife, Lorna, and Mr. Ronnie Skelton, the Minister of Health, Pastor Klein, the Chairman of the Hospital at Hospice Authority, and everybody else who's here. I think it's really a wonderful occasion to be here to see what Dr. Vanderpool and his wife Jean together, because they have been working as a team. I understand, I've always understood that to see what they have wrought out of something that started, a building that the facility started so many years ago. Now, from a building which was first an old fort to a first-class hospital facility for the people of the British Virgin Islands and other people who would like to come as well. I'll just have to comment a little bit on the history that Dr. Van der Poel presented. Yes, the building was an old fort, Dutch fort. And yes, as a youngster growing up in Rotown, especially Lower Rotown, we did play coop, as you called it, coop, and cowboys and Indians, and other games here in the alleys of this old building after my uncle Leopold Smith had started work on the construction of that hotel that really never functioned. But it was actually quite a nice place to enjoy various kinds of activities. And then, of course, there was the old Bougainvillea Clinic, which was started by Dr. Robin Tellesol, and he just gave you the history of how it got started and why it got started. But it actually was a very good thing, because he was able to provide alternate services and additional services to people's hospital. And what is, I think, was very interesting is that that was our first attempt at medical tourism. We actually, something we're pursuing assiduously right now. The Minister of Health will probably tell you a bit more about it. But I distinctly recall seeing advertisements by Dr. Tadasan to anybody, come and have your surgery in the, and recuperate in the sun, something like that, right? And so he attracted patients from all over the world, assisted greatly by Dr. Ralph Bloxman, who Dr. Tadasan told everybody, taught him how to do plastic surgery by drawing some lines in the sand. Is it at Pete Island? His first plastic surgery case. Now, what is the new Bougainvillea Clinic? What is this like? And Dr. Stephanie just explained some of the facilities in this new clinic. And it's really something special. Bougainvillea Clinic, a variety of specialists here on the islands, for example, and Stephanie mentioned them, including general surgery, orthopedics, ear, nose and throat surgery, and even emergency care at the associated UK facilities. And that is something that I found quite interesting, to provide emergency care is something that could be very challenging for a private institution. And I know that Dr. Van der Poel has tried it, because sometimes there is a need for such alternatives. The Bougainvillea Clinic provides an alternative first-class facility for persons needing medical care in the BVI. And this is the case in most countries in the world. For example, in the Bahamas, where I did my internship, there's the Racine Clinic, which is a first-class clinic, which provided alternate care in all the various specialties. In Antigua and Barbados, in almost every Caribbean country, there are private medical hospitals, and they're necessary. And you go back to the United Kingdom, which had one of the first national health care programs in the world. And they have the famous Harley Street. And I visited there a couple of years ago and paid the doctor that I went to see about $5,000 for an examination. And Harley Street is known to be expensive, but it's known to also be good value. The reality is that private medical care provided to the high standard is necessary, and this is so for a variety of reasons. It includes, for example, generally gives more privacy to patients, quicker access, and very importantly, it gives choice to persons. You know, you go to the general hospital and basically you are treated by the doctors who work at the hospital, but then you have the alternative of being able to access care from a private hospital in the BVI, which is very important. I'd like to just finally say a few things about Dr. Van der Poel, the physician Dr. Van der Poel. person choosing a specialty, he considered the needs of the territory. And we actually discussed it with me because there were various fields open to him at that time. Maybe he had interest in surgery or in obstetrics and gynecology, etc. But we discussed the matter, and always having the interest of the territory at heart, Dr. Van der Poel recognized that going into internal medicine would serve the country better, because I was there as a general practitioner, a surgeon. Dr. Pickering, Dr. Bowley before him, was there as an obstetrician gynecologist. And the other major field that needed to be filled was internal medicine. And he agreed that he would go and do that. He went off to the United Kingdom and he got trained. And when he got back home, he displayed dedication to his work. He had intimate knowledge of his field, and he had desire to provide more for the people of this territory. All the attributes of a highly qualified, well-trained internist who could perform at a high level in his specialty in any medical facility in the world. And anybody will tell you that, Dr. Van der Poel. When he was at the hospital, at People's Hospital, we all worked together as a team. It was really good teamwork, taking care of whatever came along. In those days, in the early days, Puerto Rico was not as accessible as it was since then. But we all worked together to take care of all the patients who came to People's Hospital. Working as emergency room doctors, as specialists, and also on call every night of the year, that's 365 days a year. Sometimes when you're speaking about being on call, and I speak about myself being on call, people think they think about surgeons on call, but Dr. Van der Poel's vision was also on call every night of the year, as I was. And we came, so I think because of the service we provided at People's Hospital, at that time, even at that time, we attracted patients from other islands in the Caribbean, from St. Thomas, from St. Croix, from Anguilla, etc. And that just leads me to say that while it is important to provide the facilities at People's Hospital as we're going forward, looking at medical tourism, what is important is the standard of care that we provide, both there and in Bougainville. That is what will bring patients to the BVI, to People's and to Bougainville. So Dr. Van der Poel was a good example of that. So was Dr. Tattersall when he started out with his plastic surgery in the sun. So when Dr. Van der Poel and I were in hospital working together, we had quite a few interesting times. We had a few challenging times. I remember one patient we had, we were treating together, and she was quite ill. And when she came out of the anesthetic and she in the recovery room, she started speaking in Spanish. And she was delivering all sorts of bad words, etc. And after she got awake, she said she'd never spoken a word of Spanish before. So we always, whenever I meet her now, we always exchange those words, mi amor, But it was that was a challenging experience. Dr. Van der Poel and I were quite, in fact, we had to spend a lot of time with the patient, and she did very well. She thanked us in Spanish as well. And I remember also a case of Mr. Leslie DiCastro. Leslie DiCastro was a friend of mine. We grew up together in Loro Town. And his wife, I took her to surgery one day to do a thyroidectomy. And everything went well, patient did well and everything. And now coming out of the anesthesia, normally afterwards you have a look down into the patient's throat to make sure that the lungs are functioning properly. Make sure you haven't cut the wrong thing, right? So there we were doing it. Dr. Dean Morgan was an anesthetist at that time. So there was I, me and Dr. Morgan, looking in the throat to look at the lungs. And for some reason, I think maybe we didn't pump the bag enough. The patient started to throw some PVCs and had some issues, heart problems. And we had to call Dr. Vanderpool, and he came in a rush. And with his help, everything settled down, and the patient was doing well. But during the time this was happening, when I finished my surgery, there's nothing more that the surgeon could do. I was saying to myself, what I can tell Leslie if I'm not this way? But fortunately, she did all right. And as the doctor tells us all before, there's a close working relationship between People's Hospital and the Bougainville Clinic. Sometimes, you know, there'll be need for some equipment that that the Bougainville didn't have that we loaned. Sometimes Dr. Tasso will come and assist the case. Sometimes Dr. Vanderpool will be called to come in with his specialty in internal medicine to assist there. And I have to give Dr. Tadasol the thanks, because when I was there as a surgeon and when I became chief medical officer and had to travel a lot, Dr. Tadasol always stepped in to give cover without, I didn't even have to ask him, he just automatically be there to step in, as Dr. Vanderpool recently. So I just want to conclude by saying that we all here in BVI should have gratitude and say thanks to Dr. Vanderpool for all his years in service at People's Hospital, service in this country. And I know that his aims all have also been to provide as good a service and a variety of services so the people of BVI could benefit. So thank you, Dr. Vanderpool. And
thank you, Premier, for that very enlightened and very fitting address for the occasion. Next, we will have an address by the Minister of Health, the Honorable Dr. Ronnie Skelton. Doctor. Mr. Ronnie Skelton, thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Master of Ceremony, Dr. Stephanie Vanderpool. Like Dr. Smith, before I start, like Dr. Smith, I too run the halls in the tunnels of this building, playing coop. Premier Dr. D. Orlando Smith and Mrs. Smith, Bishop John Klein, Mr. Barry, Roy Barry, Deputy Director of the Social Security Board, Dr. Heskett Vanderpool and his wife Jean, North Jean Vanderpool, and family, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I am very pleased and honored to be here to offer my congratulations to Dr. Heskett Vanderpool and his wife, North Jean Vanderpool, as they celebrate this special milestone as pioneers in the healthcare industry of the Virgin Islands. The Vanderpools have dedicated their lives and careers to improving the standard of healthcare provided in this territory with a keen eye towards embracing the business opportunities that this industry has offered. Driven by a spirit of innovation, enterprise, their business continue to thrive as they expand the range of medical services and technologies made available to their clients. Today, as we celebrate the expansion of Bougainville Clinic, now the first private hospital in the territory, I wish to publicly express my gratitude and commendation to the Vanderpools and all private healthcare providers who have partnered with the Government of the Virgin Islands and the Ministry of Health and Social Development to ensure that all people can access a wide variety of quality healthcare services right here at home. All expanding healthcare partnerships are important to our people and our economy from many perspectives. Apart from reducing the hassle of overseas travel, more of the money spent on healthcare services can now remain in the territory and circulate in the economy. The government has put in place the National Health Insurance System in order to help make healthcare more accessible and affordable to all. The fact that our people can choose between state-of-the-art facilities in both the public and private sectors here at home will help to ensure that everyone is able to access effective treatment and care at affordable prices when they need to do so. Our partnerships also provide the opportunity to attract patients from beyond our shores. A business model that is an important part of the Bougainvillea's tradition as a center of excellence in cosmetic surgery. As services and treatment facilities continue to expand beyond our humble beginnings, my vision is for healthcare providers in both sectors, the public and private sectors, to work closely with one another to develop systems and relationships to facilitate seamless patient-centered care at affordable cost. And so, with these few words, on behalf of the Ministry of Health and Social Development, my wife Janice, and my extended Skelton family, I once again applaud the Vanderpools and the Bougainvillea team on their accomplishments, and wish you Jehovah's continued blessing on all your endeavors. I wish the Bougainvillea Clinic Private Hospital every success in caring for its patients at a high standard of excellence, and may it continue to grow from strength to strength. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Skelton. Our third address is going to be from none other than Mr. Roy Barry, who is the Deputy Director of the Social Security Board and Director of NHI. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Stephanie. Honorable Premier Dr. D'Orlando Smith and his wife, Honorable Ronnie W. Skelton, Bishop Klein, Mr. and Mrs. Vanderpool and family, invited guests, good morning. The National Health Insurance is pleased to have been invited to witness and to bring remarks here today. Before I begin, I would like to recognize two of my colleagues from the National Health Insurance Department, Ms. Kishma Baronville and the other Dr. H. Vanderpool. And that is Dr. Harlan Vanderpool. The cooperation between a medical fraternity within the territory and NHI is an essential part of our delivering quality services and access to healthcare for our beneficiaries. One of the fundamental principles which directed our government to establish an NHI program was to improve the availability of medical services within the territory. This development is not limited to the public sector, but it rightfully includes medical facilities and services within the private sector. Today, we are here to witness the Bougainvillea Clinic launch, the expansion of its services with new operating theaters, new patient rooms, and new imaging department. Each of these areas represent the foresight of Dr. Hesketh Vanderpool and his wife and his team to respond to the persistent need by taking bold steps towards further progressing the standard, availability, and aesthetics of certain medical services here locally. We are aware that many of our beneficiaries would prefer to undergo medical treatment where possible right here at home. We at NHI are happy that they will now have even more choices within the territory that offers an excellent level of care in an equally pleasing environment. We again congratulate Dr. Vanderpool and his wife and his entire team for the work, effort, financing, and sweat equity we know has gone into this great accomplishment. We trust that it will deliver exemplary care to all who seek services here at Bougainvillea Clinic. As we continue to grow in the delivery of medical services offered, and the National Health Insurance Program's ability to continually provide enhanced access to these services, we see this ceremony as a definite step in the right direction towards making good on our collective responsibilities. NHI will look ahead to even further development of medical services in other areas throughout the public and private sectors within our Virgin Islands. Together, we continue to partner to accomplish our goals for even greater access to healthcare for all. And I say congratulations to Mr. and Mrs. Rantipoza and family on this great achievement.
Thank you, Mr. Barry. And thank you all for your kind words. It really has means a lot to our family to have the support of the territory and our fellow countrymen in so many ways. Next, we're going to have another special selection by my brother, Mr. Jason Vanderpool.
I think this is a very special occasion for more than one reason. You know, of course, my father has been accomplishing some amazing things, but he's always the one to mention that no one man is an island. So none of us would be here if we didn't have the right people in our life. We would never be where we are. If we didn't have the support of others, if we didn't have the Lord of God and the mercy of God watching down on us, that, you know, I know I personally could have been somewhere a lot less favorable if I didn't have the love of my family, love of my grandmother, love of God, watching down on me all the time. So that's why I think this song is very fitting for what we are celebrating here today. And I'm going to sing Never Would Have Made It. So if you guys know it, feel free to sing along with this. Let's go.
And never would have made it. Never would have made it without you. I would have lost it all, but now I see that you were there for me. And I say, never would have made it. I never would have made it out. I would have lost it all, but now I see that you were there for me. And I'm stronger, and I'm wiser, and I'm better, so much better. I would have lost it all. When I look back on all that I've been through, I realize it was you. It was you I held on to. Never would have made it. No, I never made it without you. I would have lost my mind a long time ago if it hadn't been for you. And this is what I know. I never would have made it.
Thank you, guys.
I would have lost my mind, but thanks to you and you and you, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better. I'm better. I made it through all my mess, made it through all my tests, and I know I'm better, I'm wiser, I'm stronger, so much stronger. I can tell you right now that I made it through, and we all made it through. I never would have made it. I never would have made it without you. I would have lost it a long time ago. But thanks to you and you, thank you, Lord, never would have made it. No. Without you, I would have lost my mind. I would have gave up. But you were right there. You were right there. I never would have made it. Thank you, Jesus. I never would have made it. No, 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 no.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Jason. That was a wonderful and very appropriate song. Now we are going to invite Bishop John Klein to give the blessing for the expanded facilities. Bishop Klein.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I want to ask you to stand. Stephen has played very skillfully, as he normally. You're still my favorite saxophone player. You're so smooth, and Jason has sung some of the more contemporary gospel. So why don't we do some? Why don't we go back and do a little traditional something? Is that all right? To God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin. And open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. You may be seated. I just wanted to, before I pray and offer the blessings, to give my congratulations to Dr. Vanderpool, and I call her Sister Jean. They are such faithful members of the New Life Baptist Church, and been my friends, my supporters, my encouragers over the years. The 24 plus years I've been at the New Life Baptist Church, and I just want to say thank you and congratulations. Dr. Vanderpool has a very tenacious drive, and he is very focused, and he's made the healthcare in the BVI one of his passions. And I know he's developed some other passions like telecommunications over the past years, but I know that healthcare, the quality of it, the availability of it, has been a driving force of his life. And he's been innovative, he's been a forerunner for many things, and Doc, just keep going. Congratulations, and of course, in all of your success, I can truly say that you have never not allowed God to be your anchor, and Sister Jean and family to be your stabilizing force. And so, yeah, you got so much further to go. So at this time, we're going to lend ourselves to prayer and to ask God's blessings upon the opening of this facility and the theater and the surgical ward and the imaging department. So let us bow our heads and we're going to pray. Eternal God, creator and ruler of all things, we come to you today giving thanks. We realize and we recognize that you are the source of all blessings. It is in you we live and move and have our being. It is from you we get our strength. You download ideas and you put purpose in our hearts and in our minds. And it is all to fulfill a need or meet a need that is here on earth. And Dr. Vanderpool and this family has found their purpose in meeting the needs of the healthcare of this territory. And we want to say thank you. Father, we turn our attention to this facility, the operating theater, the surgical ward, the imaging department that will be here to serve the BVI community. We pray, God, that all that access care here will find it a pleasant experience. We pray that you will saturate these walls and these rooms with people and surround them with people that are loving and offer them patient-centered care. That you would guide the hands of every physician, every caretaker that is come into this facility to offer care, that they will have good success in whatever they do. So Father, we lift up our voices, we lift up our hearts, we lift up our hands to you in thanksgiving and praise. To say, God, now, we ask your divine blessings upon this facility, this Bougainvillea Clinic, that you will bless it, that you will protect it from hurt and harm and danger, from earthquakes, from fire, from theft, or from whatever may seek to inhibit its operation, Father. We pray for the nurses and the doctors and the administrative staff that will be operating here, that you will keep them also in good health. We pray for this family, this Vanderpool family, that you will continue to give them visions and downloads for the future and for the needs of this territory when it comes to healthcare. So thank you. We ask your divine blessings in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the people say, Amen.
Thank you, Bishop Klein, for that very appropriate and wonderful blessing. As we get the ribbon into position for the official ribbon cutting, we wanted to invite Dr. and Mrs. Vanderpool up to the front. And joining them is our clinic manager, Mrs. Asha Black. So on this day, the 18th of March, 2017, through much of the efforts of many, many, many people involved, we are very pleased and honored and appreciative to cut the ribbon on the official opening of our new facilities at the Bougainvillea Clinic. And now we're going to have Dr. Heskett Vanderpool join us on stage for the vote of thanks.
Giving a vote of thanks for something like this is a very difficult task, believe it or not. There are so many people to thank. There were some doctors who have been contributing services here that were inadvertently left out. We have, I like Dr. Marjorie Yee Singh to stand in the back there. She has been one of our, she doesn't actually work for the Bougainvillea Clinic or Eureka, but she's here to provide services. If you So thank you very much, Dr. Yee Singh. I would, and there are one or two others. Yes. Any project of this size and nature is a huge team effort. And in the process of giving thanks to the people who have done work, sometimes we inadvertently leave out people that were foundational. Very often we remember the last few people that were doing the work, we remember them. But then there were many people in the background who put in their piece of work, and occasionally we forget. So I'll try not to forget many. And I try to approach this thing a bit systematically. My daughter tells me I'm a, you know, we have these different personality types. She says I'm kind of dominant, inspiring, but not as organized as you'd like me to be. And I'm thankful that I have my dear wife, Jean, who is the organizer. I have often created an example of imagining somebody buying a car and taking it out of the box in pieces, and I try to put it together, but my wife Jean comes behind and she makes sure all the tensions, the right torque, or the right bolts, and everything is gear. I make the car look like it's functioning, but if you were to go down the road in the car that I create, it will probably fall apart not far down the road. But with her behind the scenes and in the middle of it, just she makes sure it functions properly. So in terms of planning, when we started out, there are different aspects to the planning, and the initial part over there was designed by OBM, but subsequently, I don't know if Mr. Delvin Mercer is here from, he promised to be here. Delvin Mercer of Romney Penn and Associate Architects, Romney Penn Architects, were the main architects that caused this building to be what you see it as today. So I'd like to thank both Romney Penn Architects and Delvin Mercer for the work that they have done. I'm going to mention another name that nobody around here is going to know. There's a gentleman called Keith Lashley from a big hospital architectural firm that kind of did some work on the side for me, not through that big. I couldn't afford the fees that they were going to charge, so he kind of helped me out somewhat to make sure that the hospital specifications were being met. And then there are people called medical equipment planners, and there are a bunch of people in that respect. The interior design of the place was done by Penny Johnson, who formerly of OBM and now from Island Services. So she's been one involved in the interior design and so forth. She wouldn't have had anything to put her interior design on without the construction being done by my faithful builder, Mr. Vincent Mills. Where is Mr. Vincent Mills? Mr. Mills, take a bow, Mr. Mills. And you have had some very, very dedicated workers who have been with you throughout the 7 years, and there are others who have come and gone. So we'd like to thank you and your team. And I have your name mentioned 3 or 4 times. I have Vincent Mills, Vincent Mills, Vincent Mills, and team. In the process, we also have the utilities and special works. And my electrician sent from God, the Reverend and the Bishop, I call you Bishop, but you go as Reverend Elroy Leibert and team, and he's had a fantastic team. Very, very flexible, a very humble man, just no noise at all. He just do what he has to do. And then we have the air conditioning works. Air conditioning in a hospital is a special job, ladies and gentlemen. It is not your usual kind of office air conditioning. And there's some very, very special things that go, and it makes it extremely expensive, time consuming, but you have to get it done. I started out with initially with Mr. Todman and his group, and subsequently ended up with Al Marine and Co. Anybody from Todman or Al Marine is here today? They were invited, no? Okay, but in the process, you know, they are local guys that do good work. But hospital, as I said, hospital air conditioning is special. And I have with me here today Mr. Samuel Moreno. Samuel, stand up for me. Samuel came to do a little job and he ended up, he's been here many, many months now. He is an air conditioning architect, he's an electrician, he's all kinds of things. He's an electrical engineer that has done a... Samuel, man, you look well. Come up front, man. You look special today. Look at you. Normally goes around, you know, looking a bit as in work. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. Thank you. Yes. Yes. Then we have Mr. O'Neill. Is he here? O'Neill Pagan. O'Neill came to me about more than 7 years ago to deal with medical gases. And if any of you know about medical gases, most of you don't know about medical gases, but it's an extremely technical work. I know that the Minister of Health knows that if you don't put in the medical gases properly, you have to take them back out and put them in again. And that can be, you can end up having to do the work to meet a certain standard. So Mr. O'Neill, thank you very much. I'd just like to thank you. His work isn't finished yet. In addition to medical gases, he has been the one that, come on Mr. O'Neill, he has installed now Mr. Mills, I should be celebrating you like this, right? Because I'm a little excited about these guys, but I will take you for granted. You're not taken for granted, okay? So O'Neill has installed medical gases throughout you. When you look at a building, you just see ceilings and you see little outlets, but you don't know what actually goes above the ceiling tile and in the walls and so on to make this happen. So the medical gases, the operating room lights are special, the booms. I didn't know what a boom was. I thought a boom was something like that on a crane. But you have these booms in the operating theater to put the medical equipment on and so on, and some other special things. Thank you very much, Mr. When it came to building the operating theater, I was like, who is going to coordinate this thing? I mean, the amount of stuff that I knew had to go into putting the operating theater together. And up came a gentleman by the name of Mr. Eduardo Guijing. Mr. Guijing, come on up. It seemed like the whole of Puerto Rico is over here, by the way. But there might be a reason for that. But anyhow, I'm glad for whatever happened in Puerto Rico is helping me out over here. Thanks. Mr. Guijing is a really specialized contractor that has done a lot of work in hospitals. And he makes it look simple, but it's a very, very complex task to put together an operating theater and the supporting facilities. I don't know if you have Mr. Rinel Turnbull here. Where's Mr. Turnbull? Is he here? Mr. Rinel Turnbull has been my communications person, installing the various forms of computer stuff and other forms of communication. Okay, then we have a few other people that I would like to mention. Ellsworth Percival, the man for the steel and iron works. Mr. Percival, are you in the back there? Thank you very much. Yes. And there's another gentleman called Jose Hatchett. Yeah, he too has done some work on the air conditioning. To because here we have something called a chill water system. And there are very few chill water systems installed in the BVI. But they tell me while it's much more expensive to put it in, it operates more efficiently. So I'm going to have to take away a little bit of it's going to help me with the electricity costs. The many heavy equipment operators from Ishmael Hodge, a number of different Smiths operating backhoes and so on and so on, and Mr. Maduro. Mr. Louis Wells and his team have been very instrumental. Where's Mr. Wells and his team? Louis Wells, they are still upstairs probably, or so many stuff that they did. And then I'm going to mention Mr. Ezekiel Hubert Wells. Stand up, Hubert. He's really my accountant, believe it or not, but he turned into the project manager. He turned into the project manager and has done an excellent job at it. Special thanks go to the Bougainvillea staff, who have had to tolerate a lot. I'm going to say to you that when you try to put together, when you have a functioning hospital, the hospital is functioning, you know, operations are happening, construction is going on, things are changing. It's not an easy task, and it's amazing that the staff have tolerated. Sometimes they didn't tolerate it, but they have tolerated well. They have done an excellent job of being here and working with us and the patients. And the patients have been also tolerant. One patient actually woke up and said, "I set up here to be a quiet place," and she asked me back for her money, because when she woke up, she said she heard a jackhammer in her ear and she couldn't tolerate it. But I think she was a little tricky, but she got the full service and still got back her money, right? So now I'm talking about Bougainvillea staff, but there is a company named Eureka Medical Clinic that actually owns Bougainvillea Clinic. So the Eureka Medical Clinic is the parent company that owns, that pays when Bougainvillea Clinic can't pay the bank, Eureka Medical pays the bank. So that's basically, and the staff at Eureka Medical have been also very tolerant of me slipping away so often. I'm over here about 3 or 4 times a day, and my staff, I get an earful sometimes, but I have to butter them up, and they have been very, very tolerant. So that's them. I said this, I was telling them, the chairperson, that there should be 2 votes of thanks. One for the construction side. I probably missed a few people. I don't know if I missed anybody on the construction side. But there's also a second vote of thanks. Where's Asha? I asked Miss Asha Black to put together a special vote of thanks for the person that put together the program. So she's going to quickly say something. I'm sorry.
He's always doing this to me. Always on the spot. I'm happy you mentioned the Bougainvillea team, because they have been the support that we needed to get the construction, even just this program, together. And I'd like to give special thanks to Mylene. She put together our invitations, our booklet that you have there, and she did a wonderful job with the graphics and everything. So I want to give her a special thanks for that. Give her a hand, please. And Mylene. I really put pressure on Mylene, and she copes very well with it. I'd like to thank Summit Printing for getting our invitations and our programs ready for today. Thanks to them. French Deli for the beautiful refreshments, the lovely refreshments we'll be enjoying after this program. Thanks, French Deli, and special thanks to Enda, who put all of that together. Thanks, Enda. I'd like to thank Patsy Lake and her team for putting the venue together, all the decorations, and getting us placed very well. And I'd also like to thank the team from Papaya's Rental for getting our staging and sound up and running. Thank you very much. And to the team again from Bougainvillea, big up yourself, all right?
Thank you, Ashley. So to bring this to a quick close, where we can visit the facility, see what it's about, and to enjoy the goodies that are set in the back. I'm hungry right now myself. And let me just finish. I think you may have gotten the impression that the Geneva Harrigan medical surgical ward is just these three rooms. But no, it's actually the whole of this floor. It happens that things are happening in stages, so we've just completed these three rooms as they are, pretty much as they ought to be. It's never 100% complete yet. And then once we have, once we start using these fully, we have already started to use them, we are going to turn our attention to the other wards. Thank you all again for coming, and I'm really pleased that you give us, the clinic, this kind of support. Thank you very much.
My children sometimes feel unappreciated because I don't express it as often. But I'd like to thank especially my big doctor, Stephanie Bantipool,
for coming down from her busy schedule to help us here. I'd like to thank Stephen and Jason for coming. I think they did excellent renditions. Here we have, this is the smaller of the two operating rooms. This, again, I'd like to talk about my special air conditioning. These things, when an operation goes on, as soon as you strip on the operating clock, this circulates the air. Every 3 minutes, it gives you fresh air from outside that comes in. It's all filtered and everything. And then when the clock goes off, it kind of slows down the exchange of the air every 3 times an hour. So 20 times while the operation is going on, and then subsequently. So here you have, so basically with the various things, you have two monitors if you're doing like laparoscopic or other arthroscopic operations. So the doctor can look here while the nurse can, so it's very funny.
This place is beautiful. This matches anything we have in the U.S., top notch. One of the things I like the most are the overhead booms, because it makes the room cleaning very easy. You can manipulate things and position things the way you need to. It has two screens, and that's very important for doing some shoulder surgeries, because sometimes we operate on the back side of the patient, or if we're on the front side of the patient, so we're not trying to operate in mirror image. It makes it very, very nice, so they did a great job here.
Excellent.
Thank you very much. There's actually potential for me to put a camera right in there so you can take video pictures of the actual operation while it's in progress. These are the latest LED lights that can do all kinds of things. This is for imaging, to see inside patients with x-rays while you're doing the procedures. So there's a whole bunch of, what you see here is just a roof. But there's about 6 feet between here and the roof. That is full of other, the amount of pipe. I've never seen so many pipes in my tubes in my life. I wanted to know what you were doing. So you have the humidity is controlled and all kind of stuff in here, basically. So the wall especially, you have this thing here, you can wipe down easily. The floor is a special anti-static floor and so on. It's not to be cleaned, it takes some special cleaning.